to headphone or not to headphone? That is the question. It's a question that many, many artists have struggled with in front of me throughout the years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's funny, isn't it? Like, I'm used to hearing myself in these things because it's a, you know, I need to hear the music and connect with it. A lot of artists don't like to hear themselves in headphones.
That's weird.
Kind of weird, right?
Yeah.
They prefer just to talk without them.
Yeah, I can't. I have to use the headphones.
Got to use the headphones.
Yeah.
Volume okay?
Yes, sir.
It's great to finally see you again. Maynard James Keenan from Tool is joining us live on the show. And I was in New Zealand last week when I got a text from a colleague who works in the show. He said, hey, Maynard's going to come in live on the show. I got this sort of sense of anticipation and excitement that you sort of get when you realize that it's not a job. It's like, this is, I'm a fan. Like, I'm a real fan. And so there's a look on your face is priceless. Yeah, exactly. This is where it's going to get real deep and weird and creepy. No, I'm a real fan. And I'm really excited to be able to talk to you about this new music and have you in the studio. How's the last few days for you sort of been when now the album is, you can put the knife down. It's cool. Oh, there's a desk between us. How has the last few days for you been once the album has been out? How do you decompress when it's finally out?
Yeah.
Truth is always best.
Okay. It's harvest, so we're buried in, I mean, I'm buried in grapes. Mm. And it's me and my winemaker buddy, Tim White, making wine. So it's great to try to step away from that and check in to see where things are at. Mm-hmm. But to be honest, I finished up my vocals last year during harvest, like between press loads. I was on the mic downstairs in the studio and then back onto the forklift making wine. So for me, this was last year. Right now there's fruit and
that's the moment.
Yeah.
That's the moment you're in.
Make hay.
You led us into an interesting little part of the process there, which I think, you know, real fans have known that the way you make music is different to a lot of other artists. And, you know, the guys are off kind of writing and constructing and arranging. And then ultimately you hear something of an arrangement that you work to. Fair to say?
Yeah, fair to say. Yeah. There used to be a lot more involved earlier on.
Mm.
But as our personalities grew stronger and more stubborn, it's best to allow the other three stubborn people to be in a room and fight it out. And then I kind of like pick up what's left and go, okay, I'm going to run with this, right?
So when you hear a piece of music like Fear Inoculum for the first time and it's some form of arrangement, and obviously you'll go and you'll move things around according to what moves you and the words and the sentiment starts to take shape and the song changes shape. But the first time you hear that in some arranged form, I suppose the nerdy question is like, how legit finished is it? Even down to the sound. I mean, do they give you a pretty good mix and a pretty good idea of what it's emotionally
like? No, there's a lot of, you know, over the years it's been pieces. 12 years ago, 10 years ago, it was in various pieces, and what pieces are going to go where. Mm. Are they going to end up in this piece or are they going to end up in that full piece? Mm. So it ends up being, over time, you know, it ends up kind of falling into a general realm, but it's, you have to wait until they absolutely put a stamp of like, this is finished, because you can't decorate the house until the foundation is poured.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Then there's the walls, then there's the doors, you know, so I'm kind of, I'm the interior decorator.
So when you finally get the...
I choose the paint.
Exactly. When you get the room that you get to design within.
Yeah.
How do you feel when that music arrives for you and you're at home, I guess, in Arizona, and music arrives from your friends, different to how most bands do it? How do you feel?
It depends on the piece, right? So you have to really take time to find your way through it. We're all changing. We're all going in different, you know, we're doing different things and developing, you know, with age. So you have to kind of find your way in that piece and catch up on a month of time that's gone by. Maybe some small pieces changed and you have to identify, you know, where's Waldo? Like, try to figure out where that changed. And so whatever you've established might have to be completely rewritten because Waldo moved.
Do you ever have that moment when you're listening to a piece of music and you get that same feeling that you would get if you were listening to someone as a fan? Like, you go, oh my God, this is incredible. What have they made? This is unbelievable.
No. Because it's all, to me, it's all puzzles. It's what you're trying to do is build the emotion, try to find your way in it to then open that part up to pursue that emotional moment. Mm. But initially, it's math, it's puzzles, it's a problem to be solved. So you have to kind of come at it with a very clinical approach.
Wow, and get to the point of emotion. At the end.
Where your space is.
Some
films start with, start right off with dialogue. We don't really start films with dialogue in our world.
Yeah.
We start with, what is the setting? Is it a plane landing? Is it a plane taking off? Is it an island? Is it a desert? Is it in a mall? There's all these things you have to kind of set up with those arrangements to figure out what is the actual, you're kind of painting a picture here. So before I start introducing the character to you or characters, I have to let you figure out where we are first.
Mm-hmm.
And so as a writer of the characters, I have to then do the same thing. I have to wait to see what the setting is and where is it going to end. If I don't know where it ends, I can't help you write the story. I can't help you write the character. So the song has to have an ending.
Mm-hmm.
I could do all the stuff in the middle, but then you end up with there's all this cool stuff, and then there's the last season of Game of Thrones.
So to me, it's really fascinating because I've heard you, you're okay. What did you like? Did you like the previous seasons of Game of Thrones?
Yes, sir.
But you didn't like the last one?
I rewrote it.
You did?
It's good. I got it.
You got it
covered.
You got it covered?
Yeah.
Outstanding. Looking forward to seeing that.
Me and my friends rewrote it.
How did it end?
Great.
Oh, good.
Fantastic.
Good. Excellent. Oh man, your face when I said I was a fan, it's funny because I feel like you've had this relationship as a band with your fans, which is very unique. You know what I mean? I know you respect, you can leave the knife. I know that you respect and you love us, but at the same time, you also like to play with us and you also like to have fun. And I wonder kind of how it is because your band does instill this sense of real passion in people. You couldn't have taken as long as you've taken and...
No, they're extremely, extremely patient people.
Yeah,
absolutely. Well, and some not.
Yeah, I know. I know.
Those are the ones we're concerned about. The ones that are not patient.
Can you even get your head around the fact that your music gets people to a point of anger when it doesn't come?
That doesn't make any sense to me. Mm. It's they're rock songs.
So how does it get to the place where it's not just rock songs then?
I don't know. And that's I guess that's the puzzle. I just don't, I'm just not that important. None of us in this band are that important for you to put that much on us. Mm. We're just individuals making art. It doesn't make any sense to me. I'm not different. I'm not better. None of that. So it will always be a puzzle to me why you would want my autograph. Does not compute to me.
Do you sign them?
No, it's just weird. It's just a weird thing.
So how do you
go ask that stranger at the counter to get an autograph then? Because it makes as much sense to me.
But that digs us into the psyche of the fan and why people are, love a piece of art or love a song or love a movie or love something that inspires them to the point where they want to get close.
So ask the song for an autograph. Because we barely, if we're doing our jobs as artists, we're bringing our experience to the table. We're bringing our intuition to the table. But in a way, we're getting the heck out of the way.
Yeah.
To allow the thing to happen.
Yeah.
So... in that getting out of the way, you have to acknowledge that it might not have much to do with us at all.
Yeah.
It's some other thing happening.
Are you good at saying
that? If it's resonating that deep with you, then we've kind of tapped into some psyche thing that has nothing to do with the egos that are doing it.
Mm.
So don't put all the focus on the egos. They're a mess. They're paranoid, they're stubborn, they're arrogant, they're those egos that you constantly are looking at for autographs and some kind of give them accolades. Stop that. Give the peace accolades.
Is that to a degree why you chose after the Einmatur, I should say, to perform from the back of the stage?
Oh no, that was just logistics, sound.
Sound?
Yeah, it's sound. Because From that position, we have now a polygon, mm-hmm. so we can all see each other. Mm. In the front, if you want a clown, I suppose I could be a clown, but the clown can't see the rest of the band. We can't actually perform better. The mic being in line with the drums, actually there's less bleed into the mic from the cymbals, from everything. I'm not now in front of the guitar or bass cabinets, so there's isolation with the mic, and we can all see each other. And I'm no farther back than Danny. So I don't know why there's an issue.
No issue at all. I think at first it was strange because I'd seen you on that tour and I enjoyed the traditional framework because as a frontman, you're compelling. And you were wearing, I think you were wearing, was the body paint tour. So it would, various messages would come up on your body according to the light that you were using.
But I found that I couldn't hear as well.
That's right.
The isolation wasn't proper in the mic. The sound, the front of house guy was having a harder time. With the sound, and it just ended up unfolding. Oh, look, we just solved a piece of the puzzle. If I don't need to be up front, then now this sounds better. Are you here? Are you here to watch us dance around, or are you here to hear this music? I think, in my mind, I chose one. You're here to hear these things. We'll put on a show for you. You can watch the show, but the sound is more important.
I agree, and it served you really well in the sense that it actually. And getting back to your previous point, it focuses us as fans on the music in a much deeper way than on the bells and the whistles and the, I'm a rock star.
Everyone would love to be David Lee Roth. Wouldn't, no?
Sure. Well, on stage, perhaps.
Nice one.
In other areas of life, I'm not so sure.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, I think there's that as a kid, you're like, oh man, it'd be great like to run around in your underwear and do those things.
Which you did. For a time.
And then I realized that's not really, it's irrelevant to the music.
Yeah.
So I moved on to what I felt was a better approach to presenting the art.
Fear Inoculum is to me, a sensitive record. You know, it's very vulnerable and very open. And it's to me, and I've listened to it multiple times, but it'll take me a lot longer to be prepared for this. So I'll just dive off the cliff and hope I land with any bones unbroken. You know, for me as a record, there's a yearning for some kind of communication, which has been permeating through your music for some time, I feel. But in this particular case, it's a real kind of, you know, you really want us to come together, I feel, on this record, to let go of any fear that we may be harboring, is the overarching theme I'm getting from the record. There are obviously other things going on, but that's what I take from it. How far off the mark am I? Or on the mark?
Way off.
Way off.
or right on. Or not at all on. Too vague?
Perfect.
I think with any instruction I've had from, from writers, prose, poetry, just artists in general, painters, sculptors, winemakers. A lot of it is get out of the way, but also create from where you are or what you have.
Yeah,
right. You can't just go into the cellar and create an amazing world class Grand Cru wine in your cellar if you don't have the source material to do those things. Right. So write from where you are, write from what you know. So I feel like this record is, kind of a reflection of that, trying to chronicle where are we, where am I, you know, 'cause a lot of these stories, you know, they're not coming from the other three guys, they're coming from me. So, that's my one job, is to tell stories from my perspective, try to, incorporate other characters into that as best I can, but kind of right from where you are. And a lot of, I think, with age, maturity, with supposedly growing up, you have to acknowledge and let go of certain things. I think that's a hard thing for people to do.
Like what?
Just in general, people will walk around with a lot of baggage.
Mm-hmm.
And at some point, I think part of growing up, part of being mature is knowing, acknowledging that some of these things don't matter. Because you've seen it, you've seen a thing, you've had a business dealing with somebody or a relationship, and at a certain age, from the first handshake and go, I see how this plays out, mm-hmm. moving on. Mm-hmm. There's no reason to go down that path. There's no reason to hang on all that baggage because of one little thing you might get out of it mm-hmm. with all the other baggage that's going to come with it. So I think letting go of those kind of things that don't matter. He called you a name. Okay, he called me a name.
Easier said than done. A lot of people go through lots of different parts of the process to get there. You know, I've developed tools to be able to try and let go as much as possible, but it can still be a struggle. How have you approached that as a writer, but also as a person, because the two are so intricately linked? How have you got to a place now in your life where you're able to say that with confidence, that you can let go of those things?
Well, they literally don't matter.
How'd you get there?
I think farming. I think I came up in Michigan, living in the middle of an orchard and having a large garden, and when weather decides what weather is going to do, you're not in charge. And so the sooner you can not have an emotional baby fit over it and ruin your whole week and ruin everybody else's week because Mother Nature shrugged. Mm.
Prison example.
Yeah. So you just have to let those things go. They destroy stuff as long as they don't destroy you and take your life. What matters? You know, I flew in today because we're right in the middle of harvest, and so I had to drop everything and come see you because we're old friends. But at the, what? On the plane, and getting on the plane, like I had this woman was apparently never flown ever. And had a bag, her bag was full of stuff, not supposed to be in there.
Right.
And it's a carry-on flight, it's a small flight. And she's had all the stuff, and I finally had the whisper, like, not, I don't want to interject, but like, she's having a hard time. The guy behind her going, look, these things are too many ounces, there's too much liquid in your bag, you can't carry it on, so what would you like to do? Mm-hmm. He's getting really frustrated, now it's going on 15 minutes. They're holding everything up. Do you want to check your bag? Do you want to take this back out to your vehicle and come back? Mm-hmm. Do you want to throw them away? What do you want to do? And I kind of leaned over and said, the house is on fire. What do you grab? Do you grab those things or do you let those things go? She went, oh, toss them. So she tossed them. Right. They don't matter. Your hairspray. Mm-hmm. Get out of the way. Want to get on the plane.
What do you grab?
My family.
Of course.
That's the only thing that matters.
It's fun, right? Having a family.
Yeah.
It's the best.
I
mean,
that's the only thing. Mm. Family. Photo album would be next if I had time.
Yeah. What makes you laugh? You're a fan of comedy. What makes you laugh right now?
Well, it always comes down to, for good comedy, there's some kind of rub. There's the things you're not supposed to say. There's mm-hmm. things that are the ironic things that aren't supposed to happen that are collisions. You know, Curb Your Enthusiasm is a show that you laugh at, but you're also, I can't stand watching. I have to watch it from across the room because the collisions are so intense.
Yeah, The Office does that for me.
Yeah, The Office. Yeah, Ricky Gervais is the master, mm-hmm. the master of the collision. Mm-hmm. It's fantastic. Those things, I think those are the kind of things. It's the rub. Like any art, it's the rub. Mm. Where's the friction?
What makes you emotional? What gets you the other way?
They're the same. They're the same thing. They're interlocked. Comedy and tragedy are, to me, a singular thing. Mm. But it's the friction and the release of the comedy, of the art that makes you weep, cry, laugh, run, scream, shut you down. All those things are all comes from the friction and the release or the non-release of the friction. Mm. Like we've described it before as like the beautiful release of a violin, of that bow, but you forget all the pieces. That's the pieces of the wood being warped into an awkward shape and then the strings strung across it and then the friction of the bow with the horse hair. Like all those things are all friction, but the release as it's resonating off of that violin and the vibrato lifting and falling, there's your art, and it all comes from combinations of friction.
Didn't you do stand up at one point?
No.
You never did it? I did.
Sketch. I was the straight man in the sketch comedy stuff.
You were never tempted being such a fan of stand-up comedy and being someone who has some decent comic timing.
I would get annihilated. One heckler and I would be in a fetal position.
Isn't that, oh, right, okay, so you think you'd be too sensitive to put yourself through it.
Couldn't do it. I'm an empath. I take it all on.
Right.
Yeah.
It's interesting you should say that, you know, because being a member of a band that processes information to a certain degree from a distance, and you have to absorb that, like you say, in a more structural way.
Oh, God.
Tough.
Yeah, no. Hats off to people that do stand up. Mark Maron is a great example of somebody who can stand up there and take it.
Mm. What's the last thing that you did that was really scary for you? Where you challenged yourself?
Oh, in general?
Yeah.
I don't know. Anything, you know, as far as performance, entertainment, acting is dreadful to me. It's because it's the complete opposite of what I do. Those are not characters that I wrote. So I'm having to be somebody else, and I have a hard time being somebody else. I'm having a difficult enough time being myself, and now I could be somebody else. That's hard. But also just like other physical challenges, of martial arts.
And what do you get out of that? Can you talk, because for someone who doesn't actually practice martial arts, but I have friends who do, I have other disciplines, but I've never gone down that road. What was it that attracted you to that? Because I know you're fairly dedicated to that and you take it seriously.
Just challenging yourself. It's thresholds of understanding, of awareness, conscious awareness of things coming at you in ways that you hadn't expected, and being able to react to those things that activates parts of your brain that you don't necessarily normally use. So jiu-jitsu is not Muay Thai. And to do both of those things activates different parts of your brain. You have guys that are very good at doing all of those things, like, you know, watching Thug Rose or Nick Diaz amazing artists be able to have things coming at them and have them actually deal with those things coming at them and deal them back.
Mm.
It's chaos, and yet you actually survived the chaos.
You know, when I'm listening to this album from start to finish and I think about the time that's passed, and I think about the sound of the record as well, and I feel like this is almost, for me at least, as a more considered record, a record where everything is in its place very much for a reason. And all your albums are that, but I feel to a degree like the playing is more sort of soulful. I don't know how I'm trying to describe this, but it just feels like it's less trying to push us sonically into a place with just noise, and it's looking for other things. Did you feel that when you heard the music, like the band were in a different place?
Yeah, there's definitely more soundscape. There's more of a landscape, soundscape. Like we using the movie reference before, it's a setting. Where are you? And where does it take you? There's more space, and I think space is something that we're missing in general. So that was very inspiring for me when some of the pieces started coming together.
Mm.
For me to put my note on it, but then the challenge for me was, of course, not getting in the way, not standing in the middle of that landscape and ruining it, because I had to tell a story. That's that chatty friend you want to stab in the neck. Just shh, quiet. You know, when you have people that have a hard time not filling in space, they have to talk, and then they notice that you are annoyed by it, so they talk more because they're nervous, and then you're more annoyed, and eventually there's blood. And you got to buy hogs to hide the body. Now you got hogs, you got to feed the hogs.
The hogs
kill more people.
The hogs have a taste, exactly. The hogs have a taste.
Hogs are hungry, and I exactly. kill again.
And then it's like, again. Exactly. And then it's an award-winning series. On HBO.
Yeah. There's a lot more space and development in this. The soundscape, I think, are important.
Mm.
Uh, because there's so much noise nowadays, especially with just the internet in general, there's just so much coming at you, that this is going to provide you with a little bit of, I guess there's a balance between escapism and inspiration for you to go do, right? So if you can find that quiet space, I feel like I have set up a life where I can find the quiet space, but still be engaged and still be doing things, still be, you know, engaging Mother Nature with her chaos, with harvest. It keeps you very grounded, but you also have the space to think about these things and to find yourself in them and what's your role in this piece.
Well, it's like you took the human out of it in a weird way. And by that, I mean, you took yourself out of a city where all that chaos is at the hand of human beings. And that does, like, it, to me at least, that can tweak your ego, that can tweak your insecurities, your anxieties, your depressions, make you aggressive, make you frustrated, make you sad, make you happy. All the things that other people can control in your life, in my life. And you seem to have decided at some point, I'm going to go where that's not in anyone else's control. It's in the elements.
Well, it's all scale. That kind of insanity and that kind of control issues and those kind of inspired people and very active community people, you know, they're everywhere.
Yeah.
So even in a microcosm like a small town in, you know, name your state, those things still exist. But if you're not wired to, if you didn't grow up in a large city, you're not wired to be able to process that information. Mm. I grew up in a small town. I now live in a small town. It's the bandwidth that I can process.
What were those years in Los Angeles like? I mean, it permeated through one album in particular seemed to really focus on Los Angeles. And, you know, to me, every time I would fly into LA before I lived here, your band would cross my mind amongst others because I felt like you were the consummate Los Angeles band and then you moved out. So looking back on it now,
I'm not from here.
But you lived here.
I moved here in 90. Mm-hmm. I ran Screaming in 95.
You did a good job in those 5 years of describing it from your own point of view.
Empath.
Yeah. Yeah. What was it like between 90 and 95 for you?
A lot of temptation, a lot of education. Because, you know, being in a small town, of course, like I said, you have every character is represented. Mm. In a town like Los Angeles, it's, of course, exponentially larger. And when you're not important and you're not a target, you're able to sit back and observe the hunt, as it were, in the small clubs and the big clubs. And it was pretty inspiring to watch the vampires come out at night looking for the fresh blood. And when you're not important, you can witness it.
You can observe it.
Yeah.
Yeah. It ended up in some pretty instrumental moments and instrumental songs as well. It was also a great rumor that kicked around back in the day that you had gone out and bought some land in Arizona because at some point or another, Los Angeles was going to fall off the map and you would own beachfront property. I used to think that this was a joke story and I would tell all my friends this and they'd think it was funny until I was doing some additional research just to brush up yesterday and I found a quote from about 7-8 years ago where you reiterated that story. And so, in fact, it was, to a degree, the truth.
Actually, no, there's no problem at all. You guys should hang out here and just dig in. Everything's going to be fine. Everything's going to be fine.
Are you a survivalist?
Just stay where you are.
And is some part of you, even just a little part of you, a survivalist to a degree?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just, not, you know, I wouldn't call myself a homesteader, although I worked with one this harvest. Gentleman who like lives in Northern California and can pretty much live off the grid because they have systems to do so.
Mm-hmm.
I'm entertained by that. I think it's an important thing for people to. It's something I forget that people don't have. Growing up in Michigan, you know, we knew where our water was coming from. We knew we were growing our own food. You had to get the snow out of the way to get to work. There's things you had to do to survive. I don't think you have that a lot in places like the larger cities. You don't really understand where this tomato came from.
Yeah, the infrastructure
does
that. What
it took to get that tomato.
Yeah.
So I forget that people don't have any connection with those things. So I just naturally have those connections. And I think that's why I kind of came up is I started growing things or, you know, raising birds or whatever I was doing, people in Los Angeles are like, what are you doing? You can just buy that. Well, what happens when you can't buy that? What do you do then? Mm. Ah, you turn into zombies.
Beyond zombies. Going beyond zombies for a second. Or maybe going pre-zombies.
Hey.
Because zombies will probably be, there's no beyond zombies, right? Doesn't really, there's not much after that. But before that, we're at a time when people like yourselves, others who perhaps share some of your beliefs and feel like it's better to remove elements of that convenience and prepare yourself for a slightly harder graft, would consider the world to be on a path that they would recognize. And I wonder kind of like what your feelings are living to a degree, not entirely off the grid, but removed, raising a family, how you observe things and how you absorb information, where you get it from and how you process it.
Yeah. Well, I spend more time looking at I have several apps that are weather-based, showing storm fronts, showing predictions of weather patterns. The daily one that's on, you know, the weather one on the iPhone, which is not very accurate. But you know, I look at more of those things than I actually look at what the douchebag politicians are saying about each other. They're not really relevant. I'm not sure I'm answering your question. Where do I get my information from? I guess I get it from science and intuition, some kind of a balance between supposedly trusted sources of what's actually happening in front of me and what's the patterns. You look at patterns, right?
And being a parent.
And also being a historian, just like looking at what's happened in history and where things go, not just politically or socially or economically, but also environmentally, there are patterns. I think the hard part for most people to hear is that we might not be included in the next phase of this thing. That really blows people's minds. Like, oh, wait, maybe we're not supposed to be a part of the next thing.
How honest can you be with your children around that?
Not yet. I mean, she's four.
She's young.
Yeah. So, but my older son, he just graduated from UC Davis. He's going to go to law school. And
congrats.
He's going to get into politics.
Okay.
He's a fantastic cello player, but I feel like this last little row of politics kind of inspired him. He's like, rather than sitting there tweeting about it and complaining, he's like, I'd like to be part of the solution. So he's going to get into law school.
And that's great because you're not a fan of politicians, but you're a fan of your son, so that's good news for politics. And that could be the thing.
I'm a fan of local politics because we've all figured out ways to get along. Your local politics are important to figure out what's happening in your area and you know, be community driven. That's important to be part of the solution.
And was it easy for you to slot into small town Arizona when you came in and made the move?
Kind of. I'm sure there would be those that would argue that I was part of the problem, but the problem was coming with or without me. So here I am.
We're going to come back and continue talking in a second. That was really fascinating for me. Appreciate it. We're going to play a song off the brand new album called Fear Inoculum right now. Maynard James Keenan from Tool is with us. Thank you. Well, you've been out harvesting and tending to the earth and making sure that this year's harvest is a strong one. I've been monitoring, like all fans, the reaction to this new Tool album, Maynard, and people absolutely love it. Absolutely love it. And that's a real standout for fans as well. People love that song.
Great.
Maynard James Keenan is live on Beats 1 Apple Music right now. And we've got another sort of, I don't know, 15, 20 minutes, however long we can, with the artist right here. We were talking about... Actually, while we're off the air, not to betray trust, but we were talking about some signposting throughout your career. And for me, what was interesting is how certain albums really take me to a place I need to learn something, right? And the music does that. So I'm not going to put that at your feet, but the music does that. And I felt that when I heard Vicarious in 2006, taken from the album 10,000 Days, that that was the first time anyone on record had really come out and openly said, look, there's a macabre kind of life that comes from watching things around you struggle. That it kind of, the trade is that while other people suffer, ultimately you feel some kind of reward in life. That's what I took from it.
There's a German word that's been around for a long time, way before then.
Yeah. Sums that up.
Yeah.
This was obviously before that went into hyperspeed. Mm-hmm. I felt like that was more a focus on the news, on the media. And Facebook was around. There was no Instagram. There was no Twitter. There was no hyper-focused information sharing.
Yeah, but you got to remember that that this has happened throughout history. The sensationalism that manipulates the masses. There's religion is the opiate of the masses. They give you some extreme examples of things that could happen, and then if you don't toe this line, you. You are thrown into the pits of hell for mm-hmm. eternity. Mm-hmm. If you're a person who understands the celestial movements, and your people don't, and you want some big project done, you just threaten to block out the sun, mm-hmm. Or they will suffer the consequences. And you time this all right when there's an eclipse, and you raise your big staff and your robe with your white beard, and you go, "See what I mean?" And then they go, "Oh my God, he blocked out the sun." And then they get back to work because they're scared. Mm. So there's that kind of reactionary thing that's happened. Another great example is War of the Worlds radio show, mm-hmm. when people are running out like thinking that aliens have actually invaded, when they started the show with, "This is just a radio show. Oh my God, we've been invaded by aliens. Run." And people are literally leaving their homes, hiding under bridges, thinking that aliens had made it, even though they told you at the beginning of the show that that's the thing. So that kind of extreme reaction to things.
I feel like that was in the hands of the wizards,
yeah.
and in the hands of the religious leaders, and in the hands of the creatives, and now I feel like it's in our hands.
But the War of the Worlds thing was an accident.
Mm.
But when the powers that be understood the power of that reaction, then they start to manipulate your dopamine dump by massaging that in their direction.
I struggle with this because we live in a time when this kind of trade of information, this dopamine dump, as you called it, is so readily available. And there are some people who are friends of mine who argue that, you know, this is a part of the evolutionary cycle, and that the way that people share information, the train has left the building. And so trying to protect your children or protect people from that is a waste of time. But then equally, obviously, I feel like we're watching this in process. We don't know exactly where this goes.
Well, It could very much be a population control. At some point, if you feel that this marble we're rolling around on is an actual conscious thing, conscious entity, at some point it could be kind of dragging you down the rabbit hole of the infinite information resource of browsers and the internet. And at some point then it just kind of blasts a little EMP. And there's no more access to that, and you're so dumb that you don't really know what's going on, and within a decade you're all dead, except for the people that were reading actual books and actually digging actual holes and growing actual food. It could be a reset. So I agree with your friend, but I also disagree with your friend.
Mm. You know, if anyone's going to talk to you...
This is all depressing.
It's
let's get back to Taylor Swift. She's so mad right now.
could talk about Justin Bieber. He's a fan.
Hey.
He's a fan.
And he's probably a good kid.
Yeah.
It's the crap that surrounds him, the ocean of...
You know what's interesting, though, is... And I feel compelled to say this because he actually just wrote this really long, honest message, a statement. Not even a statement, just a message about his life. Did you see this? It just literally came out overnight. And it's a really thoughtful, really honest, quite heartbreaking observation about, like, I was 13 and within 2 years of being 11, I was 13 and my whole world tipped upside down.
Yeah.
I was the most popular kid and all this stuff. And then he says, I blew it. I did everything I could have done wrong.
He was never armed with the tools to handle it.
Exactly.
And
that's what he's saying.
The people surrounding him are monsters. He's living in an ocean of, am I allowed to swear on this show? Okay, never mind. I was going to say but I'm not sure I'm allowed to.
You did. It's fine. And you can.
Okay, so, you know, God bless him. He's a product of that, of those things that we've spoken about numerous times in every project I've ever done.
I think the people who have stuck with him and are closest to him have helped him. I think that there was a much broader circle that were not in his favor.
Those are the ones I'm talking about.
Yeah.
So when I make a statement like hashtag bummer, it has nothing to do with him. It has to do with, I know that the ocean of that's going to follow because he couldn't just be a quiet Tool fan. He had to say it out loud. Now I know the flood's coming from the people that don't get it and the people that think they do, and they're going to argue with each other, and it's going to be stupid.
Mm-mm. And it doesn't matter.
And it doesn't matter. And this poor kid's caught right in the crosshairs, as he was, as he is.
Mm. A Tool fan.
Well, I don't even know him. I have no idea.
You should read it. It's really, you know, it's interesting. So really, I thought it was really, really heartfelt and touching, actually. I think it was the first time anyone who's come out of that whirlwind and survived that actually had the guts to say, you know what? I was messed up. I was messed up and still am, but working at it. And it's not normal. None of it's normal. And that's why what you said right at the very beginning when I was like, oh, God, I just got to tell you I'm a fan.
I have a comedian friend of mine, Laura Milligan. Back in the day, she had a multimedia variety show called Tantrum. And her character in this variety show, her name was Tawny Port. And Tawny Port's character is a child actress who was all of a sudden famous and had all the attention rather than the recognition, just all the attention thrown upon her. And then, of course, it went from, you know, riches to rags, and she's back on the scene, this recovered, you know, reformed actress with her variety show. Mm. And she's basically, the whole thing was making fun of the child actors who have gone through all this stuff and now have come back. So we're very familiar with that process. She did it very accurately. And that show that she was doing was where a lot of the comedians you know of today were kind of working out some of their stuff in that variety show.
Mm.
Tantrum, look it up.
Will do. Tawny Port?
Yeah, Tawny Port.
Tawny Port.
Yep. Laura Milligan.
If anyone is going to ask you about the digital desert that you existed in for a long time, it almost got to a point for me, because before I even worked at Apple, and I love working here and I'm a streaming fan, but before any of that, when I was just using music on iTunes and I was downloading like everybody else, because that was how we did it, and you weren't on there, it was like...
You Tool wasn't on there.
Tool wasn't on there. You were on there. Yeah, you were on there. No, thank you. Appreciate you clearing that up.
Just saying.
Yeah, of course. Absolutely.
You spent all this time creating a thing, but once that song is done, once you've written it, and you've all agreed on it, and you've recorded it for posterity, it is now recorded. Nothing really you're going to do is going to undo that. If you want to listen to it through this can, that's not up to me. My part is done. We wrote, recorded, done the thing. So if you're one of those artists out there holding out, like, I'm only going to sell my music through this medium, shut up.
Get on with it.
Get on with it. Like, put it on vinyl, put it on 8-track, do whatever you want to do. once you've done the actual work of recording the thing, it's not going to change the thing.
I felt like a bad fan, but I had to listen to it somewhere because I would scratch these CDs up like crazy. And then I'm like, yeah, I got to buy my 15th copy of Lateralis, you know what I mean? And I get frustrated. And then I'd go to YouTube. And that's the thing I couldn't understand. Like, it's not on iTunes, it's not on streaming services, but I can go stream the whole album on YouTube. YouTube! It was just driving me crazy, and I never got my head
around it. Driving you crazy.
Okay. I never got my head around it, ever. And it drove
God bless my brothers, yeah. But sometimes they don't see the big picture because they're so focused on the art and what they're doing that sometimes the conversations don't quite make it in. And
you was, I mean, if you want to just put it in, I know that you're not thinking this way, but if you want to just, and this was, there were various arguments. One is you've already covered in other interviews, which was the start to finish album thing, whatever. Another one was that they sell a solid 3 million at Walmart every time. Why would they need to put it on iTunes? And it's like, I never got my head around that either.
We do? No, we don't.
You do all right. Not maybe at Walmart, but you do all right.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, that's not a reason either.
No, no, not at all. Yeah, just, no.
Yeah. Used to drive me crazy.
Used to drive you crazy.
And I'd forget because it'd be like 8 years in between records. And then I'd go and like try and find it. I'd be like, gosh, I forgot.
Yep.
Damn it. So a good feeling for you then to know that the music is...
Only 20 years later.
I'm going to show you a playlist I made. 20 years, was it? My God.
Lord loves a working man.
I'll show you a playlist I made, seeing as how it's not about the order of the albums. I made, as soon as it came out, I made a playlist called, where is it? Here it is. A Disrespectful Reordering of Tools, Impeccable Back Catalog, is what I called it.
Just you want to really bum them out? Just a video of you going, shuffle.
Totally. Rex. Look at that. I put Hooker with the penis straight after Vicarious. How you like that?
Boom. Sorry, Dan.
It works really well.
Shuffle.
It works really well. I'm really happy with my ultimate Tool album.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
I'm happy that you're happy.
You said something and I can't remember where it was. You were like, maybe it was here. It's been a long interview. You said,
interview is like a Tool song. Hey.
Yeah, but it's rewarding in the end.
Yes.
It is. There's a lot of very sort of stubborn, maybe even said pig-headed people, and you just didn't want to be one extra pig-head in a room full of pig-headed people. Mm-hmm. Was that hard for you to walk away when you had been a pig-head in a room full of pig-headed people?
I didn't stop being a pig-head. I just wasn't a pig-head in that room.
Better from a distance?
Yeah. I mean, because then you have to learn to accept what's coming. If I'm not going to be in there fighting the fight for what's happening, that actually is, that's a teaching moment for me. It's a teaching moment for myself to understand how to navigate what's being presented rather than being in the middle of the fight and making it take longer.
Mm.
Losing perspective because you get forest for trees in that room. Mm. So I had to step out, and which actually taught me a whole new skill by stepping out and having it presented as is, with minor adjustments. This is how I'm going to have to tell the story around a framework that exists. That was a challenge, and it took me about 10 years to figure that out. It started with Perfect Circle, because Billy would have finished things, and I would have to go, I've never done that. Mm. Let me see how I can do that.
You think it's what kept the band together, ultimately being able to detach yourself and remove yourself from that process?
Yeah, you have to understand your role in the family, right? Don't be the drunk uncle at the family reunion all the time. Like, just be the drunk uncle somewhere else.
Do you have recurring dreams?
But that metaphor didn't work. We'll work on it.
I moved on. I was trying to do your favorite.
Yeah, sorry.
Do you have recurring dreams?
Used to.
Of what?
The flying thing. My mom used to have this thing where she would fly. But I also have, recurring dreams of, usually it's a reflection of a puzzle that I'm trying to solve. And the puzzle will come up in the dream. It'll be a different setting, different scenario. but it'll have a reflection of whatever that puzzle is that I'm trying to work out.
Do you think that reflects in your writing at all?
Well, yeah, because you have to pay attention to those puzzles. Generally speaking, I'm surrounded with really good, supportive people. I'm also surrounded by people who call me out on silly things. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. That's good to have that balance of people who don't care about your career. They want you to be, you know, a better human in general. My wife is my rock. So the puzzles end up being more about the projects we're involved in, whether we're building a winery or building, you know, a restaurant or writing an album or trying to figure out a pasta recipe that keeps failing. You know, just those puzzles they're not life impacting. They're not life threatening. So the dreams come up in very innocent ways to kind of help with the puzzle solving.
Well, I think we've solved a couple. I've really enjoyed the conversation. I felt like it could have gone on and on, but for the sake of everybody else's day.
So I'm boring now? You're sounding boring.
Yeah, you're boring. You lost me. About 23 minutes.
Let me tell you more about wine.
Oh, no, don't get me wrong. I love reading about your wine.
Shut up.
I'm trying to think. We've got like 2 minutes and it's weird ending on conversations. So I'm going to pick one of the interludes off the record. Maybe Mockingbeat. It's a nice way to end.
All right.
Appreciate you.
Whatever, bro.